Hello everyone. Today I will be discussing my P3 project guided by Professor Girish Dalvi. I will be using this presentation to elaborate on certain points from the report, which would be better suited to a video presentation. First, I'll begin with an introduction and then explain the gameplay of Nirnay, elaborate on how the content and world of the game relate to the user's context, and this will be followed by answering questions like what makes this game fun or effective. The presentation will end with contextualizing the activity to the NGO's goals. I would like to add that during this presentation and while explaining the gameplay, I will use regular financial terminology, which might make the game sound too complex for the intended purpose, but this is simply for ease of explanation. The actual gameplay with the target users was conducted in Hindi and used little to no terminology. And the game was understood through play rather than a demonstration, as will be shown in this video. In this project, I've designed a playful activity for low-literate women at an NGO called Deep Griha Society in Pune. The purpose of this activity is for low-literate women to have access to and engage with financial concepts. The primary users for this activity are women who have studied up to 5th grade or have the reading and writing abilities of a 5th grader. The secondary users are the facilitators at DGS. So the facilitators can read and write in Hindi or Marathi and will be in charge of running the activity. Design goals for the intervention are: 1. That the primary user or player should be able to engage with and discuss selected financial literacy concepts. And 2, the player should have fun or enjoy the designed activity. While designing, I had a few criteria in mind that the activity should fulfill. 1, the content should be suitable for the target user. 2, it should translate well into play. 3, the activity should be suitable to the context of the NGO. It should have good usability and aesthetics. And 5, players should come away with learning. So the activity I designed was a financial board game called Nirnay. The final pack contains a board, some currency notes, asset cards, a game master's manual, and some pawns and dice. All players start at the bottom of the board and each one gets 10,000 rupees cash in the beginning. And the objective of the game is to reach the end of the board, that is retirement, with the highest amount of wealth. So to move the players, players must roll 2 dice and move them from tile to tile. On each turn, they may or may not land on event tiles. If they do, they must face the consequences on the tile. So this is an example of a spending tile where the player must pay 2,000 rupees for a sari. So in this case, they will hand over 2,000 rupees for a sari card. Another example is a positive tile where the player receives a gold ring worth rupees 3,000 from their mother. So in this case, the player receives a gold card from the cashier. While the tiles are self-explanatory, the game master may refer to the manual provided to add to the richness of the narrative. So eventually the players will arrive at a decision point, or they may pass over it. Regardless, they must stop and will be presented with a situation by the game master. So in this example, the player receives 1 lakh cash as a wedding gift. They may put it in a bank account on simple or compound interest. So based on their choice, one of the cards will be handed to them. The one on the left is their deposit with simple interest and the one on the right is compound interest. So these cards show the appreciation of their amounts over the next few decision points in the game. At this point, the game master may or may not choose to discuss the choice. Here they can compare the two amounts between simple and compound interest and reveal that compound interest would be more fruitful in the long run. So the other decision points pose similar questions that explore selected concepts, and they are explained in the report. So during the game, the players also regularly receive salaries at every decision point. So in decision point 2, they have the option to opt for Bishi or Bachatgat schemes, where they will have to pay 2,000 into Bishi every time they get their salary. So this is a way of keeping their money secure till the end of the game, and recurring payments are marked on the board so that they don't forget. Trading, so throughout the game the players have the option to liquidate their assets. The main contribution of the asset cards is to show the passage of time and appreciation of assets in the game. So the longer they keep their assets intact, the higher the returns. There are a few opportunities where players directly affect each other's wealth. So this conflict comes in the form of event tiles. For example, it's a player's birthday and they must collect 1,000 from each player as gifts. Or in a lucky draw, they may choose one player to take money from or sabotage. Among the asset cards are also everyday commodities that do not appreciate with time. So these can be traded between players during the aforementioned events like birthdays, lucky draws and all. And this is simply to add a social non-monetary exchange between the players. And it led to some entertaining moments during the playtest. So the game ends when all the players have reached retirement. At the end, all the players' wealth is tallied and the net worth is calculated. The highest amount wins. So after the game master can discuss all the decisions made and the fun moments in the game. So this game serves as an introduction to financial concepts that will be formally covered by the facilitator later in the session. In the report, I already mentioned that the content was derived from the RBI handbook, and the world building of the game was based on primary research. I had failed to mention that the choice of concepts and prioritization of messages was also based on anecdotal evidence from the user interviews. I'll describe some of the reference anecdotes briefly. With regard to the message annualization of loans and bank versus moneylender, so one participant mentioned that the moneylender had a cheaper interest rate than a bank. He only took 5% interest on the loan, whereas the bank had a higher rate of interest. However, it was revealed that the moneylender took it on a monthly basis, which by comparison to the bank was much higher per year. So this anecdote was the basis for decision point 3 in the game. Another anecdote was regarding simple versus compound interest. So the participant wanted to take a loan for her son's vehicle but calculated the interest on loan as simple interest. However, banks always give compound interest loans. So for this reason, it was necessary to look at the difference between simple and compound interest, that is decision point 1. Participants were asked what they would do with the money after they had paid off debts. Two or three participants mentioned that they would either put it in a bank or into their son's business. But a plan to diversify did not come up. So based on this, I thought that it might be an interesting concept to introduce through the game. With relation to the plot, decision point 3 about taking a 5 lakh loan for the daughter's engagement and point 6 about receiving life insurance benefits were based on real anecdotes from the interviews. In-game events were loosely based off of the interviews as well. There were events like spent 30,000 on house guests during the wedding. This was based on two interviews where participants recounted money spent on social affairs. The event about losing money due to an ATM card misplacement was based on an anecdote where a participant lost money due to an ATM scammer. So these are some of the among the many events that were taken directly from the participants' context. In keeping with the goals of endogenous games, most of the mechanics in the game were driven by the content itself. So here are some varied examples. At decision point 4, risk versus return, the player must choose an assured 50,000 rupees or roll the dice to 6 to earn 2 lakhs, all or nothing. Here the mechanic was driven by the content of low risk, low return, high risk, high return. Expenses are equal to income minus savings. So this message is operationalized in decision point 2 by taking out Bishi contributions before handing the salary to a player. The asset cards can be liquidated at any point, but if held on to until the end, assets would appreciate a lot. Cash does not appreciate at all throughout the game, so this was driven by the message that lower the liquidity, higher the return. At decision point one, the player's action of choosing between two plans and receiving a bank deposit asset card for it replicated a bank scenario where the user would choose and receive a document or receipt in return. Exchanging gifts. So in-game, there are opportunities for the players to exchange money or saris during occasions like Annaprashan, birthday, etc. So these replicate the real-world social festivities that the participants engage in. So what makes this game fun? Novelty, because they have had little, the participants have had little to no experience with narrative-based board games before. So the ability to simulate their own lives from childhood to retirement is new and exciting. Context and relatability. So the events and storyline of the game are designed specifically keeping in mind anecdotes and situations experienced in their daily life. So there's more suspension of disbelief because the diegetic world of the game seems more plausible. Money matters. So the game has regular and incremental salaries, and the player has the experience of getting richer, holding on to more cash and assets in different forms. So this kind of gameplay is new and exciting for the target users. There are chance events with the possibility of winning and losing money. These make the game more exciting. There's also the scope for social interaction. So the game is a medium for players to interact with, play, and engage in friendly conflict with each other in subjects that are familiar to them. So this could also strengthen their social relationships and give them a memorable experience. So what makes this game effective? The game makes the lesson practice first or practice driven rather than theory driven. So in this way, the player comes up with the learning through experience, and this is observed with P1 on the health insurance style. Concepts are not heavy on terminology or labels, but meaning of concepts are hidden within the situation. So for example, risk versus return and diversification. The situation brings out the concept intuitively rather than having to introduce it as a new and intimidating concept. Being able to bring up meaningful matters through the device of the game. For example, two players chose Bishi and one did not. So this opened up a door for discussion about their choices regarding Bishi, the pros and cons of the method. The game caters to the knowledge level of the users and reduces the complexity of each concept down to intuitive messages. The decision points trigger the player to think of all options and consequences before deciding, thus encouraging critical thinking with regard to finance. At decision points, the game proposes a scenario. The player chooses and is given immediate feedback on their actions. So this aspect of the simulation helps the user reflect on their choices immediately, as opposed to the real world where they might not be able to connect the dots or find patterns to form a learning. And lastly, the game master is able to build upon the gameplay and use it as a reference to discuss the concept further. As mentioned in the report, the objective of the financial literacy sessions at Deep Griha Society focused more on financial behaviors and attitudes. All their program activities encouraged the participants to make better daily decisions and change their financial attitude from short-term spending to long-term saving. They also handled issues like overspending on nicotine goodies, junk food, and social situations. While that was initially the focus of this project, I realized that the area of financial behavior was outside my domain of expertise. For those reasons, I changed the project direction after stage two. So through this design intervention, I'm not solving a problem or aiding in behavior change, but broadening the scope of their financial literacy session to include financial knowledge and competencies. Since an approach to financial knowledge was missing in their program, this activity would possibly help give the participants a more all-round learning experience.